A system S consists of a massless inextensible string of length equals 0.45 meters, with one of its ends fixed and the other end carrying a particle P whose mass is m equals 0.10 kilograms. Take g 10 meters per second squared. Number 1. S is shifted from its equilibrium position by an angle equals 90 degrees, while the string is under tension. It is then released without initial velocity. Take the horizontal plane containing Fa as a reference level for gravitational potential energy and neglect all friction.
Let's move to part 1a. Calculate the initial mechanical energy of the system as Earth when P is at point D. The mechanical energy is given by this expression, 1/2 mvd squared plus mgzd, where vd is the speed at point D and ZD is the altitude at this point relative to the reference level. But ZD equals L because ZD equals OF, which is equal to L. And VD equals zero because S is released from rest. Plugging in the numbers gives the value of the mechanical energy at point D, which is equal to 0.45 joules.
1b. Determine the expression of the mechanical energy of the system as Earth in terms of L, M, G, V, and theta, where V is the speed of P when the string passes through a position making an angle theta with the vertical. We know that the mechanical energy is given by the kinetic energy Ke plus the gravitational potential energy GPE. Then ME equals 1/2 mv squared plus mgz. Look at the figure. Z equals A prime F, but A prime F equals OF minus OA prime. Now look at the shaded triangle. Cosine theta equals the adjacent OA prime over the hypotenuse L. So we can write OA prime equals L cosine theta. So replace OA prime by L cosine theta, then that becomes OF minus L cosine theta. But OF is the length of the string, so that becomes L into 1 minus cosine theta. Replace that by this expression, so the mechanical energy becomes 1/2 mv squared plus mgl into 1 minus cosine theta.
Let's move to part 1c. Determine the value of theta where theta lies between 0 and 90 degrees, for which the kinetic energy of P is equal to the gravitational potential energy of the system as Earth. So we have Ke equals GPE. The mechanical energy is the sum of the kinetic energy and the gravitational potential energy. But let's replace the kinetic energy by GPE. Then we have ME equals 2GPE. But the expression of the gravitational potential energy is given. Then let's replace GPE by this expression. This is going to be ME equals 2mgL into 1 minus cosine theta, but all friction is neglected. Then the mechanical energy is conserved. Therefore, the value of the mechanical energy at any position between D and F is equal to 0.45 joules. Plugging in the numbers gives the value of cosine theta, which is equal to 0.50. Therefore, theta equals 60 degrees.
1D. Calculate the magnitude of the velocity V0 of P as it passes through its equilibrium position. Look at the figure. At the equilibrium position, or at the point F, the gravitational potential energy equals zero, since F belongs to the reference level of GPE. The mechanical energy is given by Ke plus GPE. GPE equals zero. The mechanical energy is conserved, so it remains 0.45 joules. Then 0.45 joules equals 1/2 mv0 squared, where m equals 0.10 kilograms. Therefore, v0 equals 3.0 meters per second.
Focus, please. This is important.
Let's move to part 2. Upon passing through the equilibrium position, the string gets cut and P makes a head-on collision with a stationary particle P1 of mass 0.20 kilograms. As a result, P1 is launched with a velocity V1 of magnitude 2.0 meters per second. Now we want to determine the magnitude V of the velocity vector V of P right after impact, and then we want to check whether the collision is elastic. Let's start by extending the x-axis positively from F to A. Before the collision, the velocity of P has a value of 3.0 meters per second. This is because as P reaches point F, it moves horizontally to the left, then it moves in the positive x direction. Now P1 is stationary before the collision. After the collision, the velocity of P is unknown, and the velocity of P1 has a value of 2.0 meters per second. This is because P1 is launched horizontally to the left, then it is launched after the collision in the positive x direction. Now, during the collision, linear momentum is conserved. Then, the linear momentum of the system before the collision is equal to the linear momentum after the collision. Now, the linear momentum before the collision is the sum of the linear momenta of P and P1 before the collision. And the linear momentum after the collision is the sum of the linear momenta of P and P1 after the collision. P0 equals MV0. P equals MV and P1 equals M1V1. Plugging in the numbers gives the value of the velocity of P right after the collision. This velocity is minus 1.0i and it is expressed in meters per second. The value of this velocity is negative, which shows that P recoils after the collision. Now we want the magnitude V of the velocity V. The magnitude is 1.0 meter per second.
Now let's determine whether the collision is elastic. The kinetic energy of the system before the collision is given by 1/2 mv0 squared plus 0. 1/2 mv0 squared is the kinetic energy of P before the collision, and 0 is the kinetic energy of P1 before the collision, and equals 0 since it was initially at rest. Replace M and V0 by their values, therefore the kinetic energy of the system P1 before the collision equals 0.45 joules. Now let's determine the kinetic energy of the system after the collision. It is given by 1/2 mv squared plus 1/2 m1v1 squared. 1/2 mv squared is the kinetic energy of P after the collision, and 1/2 m1v1 squared is the kinetic energy of P1 after the collision. Replace mv m1v1 by their values, therefore this kinetic energy equals 0.45 joules. Since the kinetic energy of the system before the collision equals to that after the collision, so we can say this collision is elastic.
Let's move to part 3. P1 is launched with a speed of 2.0 meters per second. It moves along the frictionless horizontal track FA and then rises at point A with the same speed V1 following the line of the greatest slope of the inclined plane AB. The inclined plane AB makes an angle of 30 degrees with the horizontal. Part 3A. Suppose that the friction along AB is negligible. Determine the position of point M at which P1 turns back. Let's say that here is point M. Then Vm equals 0. Now, friction is neglected, then the mechanical energy is conserved. We will apply the principle of conservation of mechanical energy between points A and M in order to determine the position of point M. Now, let's start with the mechanical energy at point A. We know that Za equals 0. P1 is at the reference level of gravitational potential energy. Then MgZa equals 0, so we still have the kinetic energy. Plugging in the numbers gives the value of the mechanical energy at point A, which is equal to 0.40 joules. Now let's move to the mechanical energy at point M. Now, Vm equals 0, then the kinetic energy at point M is 0. Now, we need to calculate Zm. Look at the figure. This is Zm. In this right-angled triangle, sine alpha equals Zm over Am. Then, Zm equals Am sine alpha. Therefore, the mechanical energy at point M equals 0 plus M1GAm sine alpha. Plugging in the numbers gives the mechanical energy at point M equals Am. So this is the mechanical energy as a function of Am. Now we are ready to apply the principle of conservation of mechanical energy between points A and M. So the mechanical energy at A equals the mechanical energy at M, then 0.40 equals Am, therefore Am equals 0.40 meters.
3B. In fact, the path AB is not frictionless, so P1 reaches point N and then turns back, with An measuring 20 centimeters. Calculate the variation in the mechanical energy of the system P1 Earth between A and N, and then deduce the magnitude of the force of friction assumed constant along the path AN. Since the particle turns back at the point N, so its speed at N equals 0. And we have seen in the previous slide, at this point N, the mechanical energy equals AN. So ME at N equals 0.20 joules. The variation in the mechanical energy between A and N is given by ME at N minus ME at A. Now, replace ME at N by 0.20 and ME at A by 0.40, then the variation in the mechanical energy between A and N equals minus 0.20 joules. Now, let's determine the magnitude of the force of friction between A and N. Using this formula, the variation in the mechanical energy is given by the sum of the work done by the non-conservative forces between A and N. But the force of friction is the only non-conservative force that does a work between A and N. So delta ME can be written as the work done by the friction. But the work done by the friction equals minus F times AN. Now replace delta ME by minus 0.20, replace AN by 0.20, therefore F equals 1.0 newton.